مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم.
الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه وأهل بيته ومن اتبع سنته أجمعين. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قال الله تبارك وتعالى بعد بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والفجر وليال عشر والشفع والوتر والليل إذا يسر هل في ذلك قسم لذي حجر ألم تر كيف فعل ربك بعاد إرم ذات العماد التي لم يخلق مثلها في البلاد وثمود الذين جابوا الصخر بالواد وفرعون ذي الأوتاد الذين طغوا في البلاد فأكثروا فيها الفساد فصب عليهم ربك صوت عذاب إن ربك لبالمرصاد فأما الإنسان إذا ما ابتلاه ربه فأكرمه ونعمه فيقول ربي أكرمن وأما إذا ما ابتلاه فقدر عليه رزقه فيقول ربي أهانن كلا بل لا تكرمون اليتيم ولا تحاضون على طعام المسكين وتأكلون التراث أكلا لما وتحبون المال حبا جما كلا إذا دكت الأرض دكا دكا وجاء ربك والملك صفا صفا وجيء يومئذ بجهنم يومئذ يتذكر الإنسان وأنى له الذكرى يقول يا ليتني قدمت لحياتي فيومئذ لا يعذب عذابه أحد ولا يوثق وثاقه أحد يا أيتها النفس المطمئنة ارجعي إلى ربك راضية مرضية فادخلي في عبادي وادخلي جنتي. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم والعاقبة للمتقين ونحن على ذلك لمن الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jalla shanahu have given us this day today for us in this beautiful opportunity in this blessed month of Rabiul Awwal to do the zikrullah. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. Today we are reading Surah Al-Fajr and the tafsir of it. This surah is the 10th surah revealed on Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the Makkah, and it is right now in Quran is the position 89. And in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have diverse topics discussed. So just as the beauty of Quran is in the time where you're talking early stages in Mecca, when Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is giving invitation to people to come to the Islam, and there is three oaths Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took. Three great nation Allah had created and what He did to them for their disobedience and for what they did the wrong. For their mischief they created, the punishment for them. Then the topic about human. Then the topic about when mankind is getting good and when he's being tested by giving and by depriving. Then the topic is about honor and respect to the orphans. And then feeding the poor and needy. And then love for the wealth. And then the end of the life of the world. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's judgment on the people and the person's feeling of what he lost, what they could have done better. And then azab is mentioned. And then finally ending up with the positive note of those who are righteous, believing and good souls, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will honor them. So there are so many topics are here that each verse may take even hour long lecture to explain it. So let's begin with this. Wal Fajr, by the dawn. No, before I go there, let's understand. This surah was revealed, as we know, in the early days of the Prophet's prophecy invitation for the people. And this surah sounds like it is at the time was revealed when the Hajj was around the corner. Because Arab had still the Hajj done, but they were doing Hajj according to whatever they liked, the way they pleased. It was not done according to the way Ibrahim al-Islam and Ismail al-Islam have initiated. So they have a lot of idol worshipping in there. So it is happening, it is reported in the history that at time they would come for Hajj every year, but they will change the dates for the Hajj. Number one. Number two, they would do is they will change the months, as they were doing in Surah that we will discuss that. So they used to do a thing called Nasi. They will move Hajj here or there. So that's one thing. Sometimes they'll make 2 months of Hajj for the business reason or for their like. Next thing they would do is they will come to Hajj, but they will not do anything which was supposed to be done in the Hajj. Yet they will start doing a idol worshipping ritual and boast about their family, their tradition, their forefathers, what they have done. So all these shirk things and what you call khurafat, the wasteful thing were done. And the Quraysh themselves, they thought that they were the chosen one. So they will not go to the Arafat. They will stop at the Mina in Muzdalifah. They will wait. They said, everybody go there and we stay here. And then they would, in the night, when they slaughter the animal and feed the people, they will boast about their forefathers, how many people they fed and whatnot. It will come in Surah Baqarah, inshallah, we'll talk more details. The other thing they would do is that each tribe will come and will worship its own idol. Like there were two idols, one name was Naila, one was Asaf. These were the two young people who were from Aus and Khazraj tribe of the Medinites, and they committed zina in the haram. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned their body into the rock, or apparently they were punished by death. And these people made their idols by carving their structure. One was put on the Safa and one was put on the Marwa. And they would come and they would only circumambulate around those two rocks. So those two idols. So this is how they have developed. Then Lat and Uzza and Manat Lat was sitting on the top of the Kaaba roof, and the other one put in certain position, so they will offer sacrifice to them. And also one thing these Quraysh have brought among themselves is that they would not let anybody to come with the ihram of their own. So people who were poor, they were forced to be naked, men, women undressed, and they will walk around the Kaaba and will have certain ritual in speaking. If anybody wants to see, can see. There's nothing to hide, so and so forth. All these kind of wasteful thing, and which is un-Islamic thing they were doing, which is what was their tradition to say. Then this time all the Arabs will come. So it has become like in India they do a Kumbh Mela or annual gathering, which has no religious significance to it, but name as religious ritual. So this was the tradition of Ibrahim and Ismail al-Islam, which has totally become wasted. But they will still come. So this is the time when Arabs were coming, the Quraysh were more scared that they, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi and his message might be intimidating or influencing, and people will join them. So they wanted to talk about this. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this time revealed this portion of the Quran. It says, wal fajr, by the qasam of the fajr, Allah taking qasam, wa means qasam in this reference, means Allah taking oath by the dawn, or as the sun breaks. There are subh kazib, there are subh sadiq. Subh kazib is the one which is a straight line which comes in the horizon before the sun rises, and then after a few minutes it vanishes. Then the subh sadiq comes in, and that is the horizontal spread lightning coming as the sun is coming up. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, I am the one who control the, by the fajr, means as the dawn breaks, I control it. Who controls the sun and earth and planetary movement, the galaxy movement, the solar system functioning? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, I am the mighty God who controls that. So by that event happening every Fajr, walayal al ashr, and the 10 nights, washafi wal witr, and the even and the odds. Shaf means even. Even number could be even days, even nights, even months, or even couples, creation, like everybody, pair, male, except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is with them. Allah has no couple and no pair. Or the odd number, which is the 9th of Zilhajjah, and the 10th, which is even number, is the Hajj celebration and the Eid al-Adha. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking oath by odd, even and odd. Wal-layli iza yasr, and by the night as it passes through. This is the night has been referred to, the night of Muzdalifah, when people are coming back from Hajj to stay in the night of the Muzdalifah. And it is one of the very, very emotional night, as people are lying there, as those of us who have performed the Hajj knows that it is a very difficult night, because we have to lay on the ground. There's no comfortable place. And now they have made a lot of things, but fact is that it is supposed to be a very short, very fast, very quick, but next day is very long, very exhaustive, very stressful and energetic day. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about this night which is passing quick. And this is the night I personally experienced, that I was in my grave. First time I experienced the grave experience when I went for my Hajj first time, because there was dark area, there was nothing. And I was laying in the storm drain they had made. I was laying there because there was no place to lie down comfortably. There was all rocks. So I laid down and felt really first time in my life that I am in my grave and how it experienced. I'm sure everybody has their own experience. So this was my experience. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هَلْ فِي ذَلِكَ قَسْمُ الْلِّذِي حِجْرٍ. Isn't it enough sign in these oaths for the person of intellect? Hijr actually means rock. Rock means something firm, like the mind when they become firm about something. The people who have intellectually sound people, the rock-hearted means they are heart and what you call the firm, his mind is like a rock, you know. So this is how which we use as a reference in English language. Okay, you know, aapka janab patthar ki zaban hai, aapne jo keh diya ek bar patthar pe, lekin is qasam ka reference hai, that isn't it enough intellect for the people of intellect. Alam tara kayfa fa'ala rabbuka bi'ad. Did you not see what your Lord did to the people of Ad? Now let's Iram Azat al-Imad. They were the people of Iram. And they were the people who were the possessor of the pillars. What is allati lam yukhlaq mislaha fil bilad? And there was none Allah has created like them ever in the creation. Now let's talk about Ad. Ad is a nation which is the king Shaddad bin Ad bin Sam bin Nuh alayhi salam. So he was a great grandson of Nuh alayhi salam. Shaddad was a king. Apparently the story goes like that he was traveling when he was a newborn. His parents were sailing and the boat got damaged with the storm or something, and his parents drowned and died, and he survived by the will of Allah on a slab of wood, and Allah commanded Jibreel Islam to take him and feed him and raise him, and then Allah made him a king. And Jibreel Islam had a sympathy and pity on him that he was child who was raised orphan. Similar time, another place which we know in the Quran is mentioned about the Samri, the one who was with the Musa alayhi salam. He took the dust from the hoofs of the horse of Jibreel Islam and put it in the calf and we become alive. His name was also Musa. So these are the two people where Jibreel Islam raised them. Now you should understand, people who are raised by Jibreel Islam fed them, but their will made them what they were. So Shaddad is one of the unrighteous man, because he had so much power and might. He ruled all over Arabian Peninsula, and he was, his power and might was as far as north to the Iraq and west to the Yemen and all the way east to the Gulf area and also to the what is known as today Saudi Arabia. So he has a very mighty country, and his place is right now is known as Ahqaf area, which is in the Oman today, which is on the south of Saudi Arabia, a little bit towards the southeast, and which is the east of Yemen. So if you see the Arabian Peninsula, you will see in the Yemen to the west, to the east, where the Oman starts, and it's in the, which is known as the Ahqaf means dunes, the desert dunes, because it's so desert that it is nothing steady there. But at one time, apparently, there was water and whatnot, and he built the underwater channel into the ground, and he made an orchard and had made pillars and made a city around it, and that's where, in those boundaries, he made a Jannah for himself. So he claimed to be the God, and he wanted to enter the Jannah. Apparently, when he, this is reported or been mentioned, when he tried to put his first step between first and second step in and out of the heaven, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took his soul off by the Malak al-Maut, and he did not enter his Jannah. And this is what is one of the story about it. But these people were being mentioned in the Quran as that Iram Azat al-Imad. They were living in the city. The city is known as Iram, or sometimes it says there was another person named Iram, but Iram is mentioned as a paradise which he built, and NASA has done a research on it in 19 some, and there's, it's on the YouTube if you want to look in, and you can see the Oman, the paradise of Iram, you will find it, and they tracked it down. There was a trail, and they find for the caravan to move for the north, south, east, west, all the directions. Caravan used to travel and trade was done. So it was a very rich country, very powerful person, very powerful king. But what he did was not the good thing. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that Alam tara kayfa fa'ala rabbuka bi'ad. Did you not see? Means past tense. Ara'aita allazi, Allah says when Prophet is seeing now. Alam tara means in the past. Allah is showing him, did you not see what your Lord did to the people of Ad? Irama zat al-imad, they were the possessor of the pillar in the city of Iram, or the people of Iram means the people, you know, that you say New Yorkers or New Karachiites or you call Jerseyan. Similarly, Irama zat al-imad, the people of Iram, the one who had the bigger pillar and column to build around their city. Allati lam yukhlaq misluha fil bilad, the one none of simile Allah has created like them. So this is one of the three mighty nations, and these were the Arab Ba'ida. So these were the original ancient Arab. No history knows about it. Quran talks about it. Quran is a witness about talking about the history. And now Arab knows about it. They were aware of that. They were Arab of the Imad. They were the people of Iram, and all this was known to that Arab. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving one reference in this surah about what your Lord did to the people of Iram. Second reference is وَسَمُودِ الَّذِينَ جَابُوا الصَّخْرَ بِالْوَادِ, and then second one is the people of Samud. Now for the people Ad, Hud alayhi salam was their prophet and messenger. He was a handsome, beautiful, powerful, mighty man. And the people of Imad, they used to be big and giant people. And some reference it is written or mentioned as these were the people who are made jinn. So this has been referred, but actually they were human, which is Quranic reference. So they were giant people, and they were very proud and arrogant of their existence. They were mighty, powerful, with the military, with the wealth, with the looks, with the thing. And they thought that they are indestructible. This is every nation thinks when they have the power, that everything is what they have is indestructible. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took the life of Shaddad before he could even enter. So Hud alayhi salam invited them to the Islam and they rejected him. Inshallah, we'll discuss about in detail and some when the zikr will come in the other surah. It is about 24 times they have mentioned about the Iman. Qawm-e-Ad. Alright, so Qawm-e-Ad has been mentioned about 24 some time in the Quran. So now the Samud. Samud were the people which is with the north of which today we have Saudi Arabia. If you travel towards the north in the Arabian Peninsula, if you have the map, you will see near Jordan border and in the Petra, and this is known as Mada'in Saleh, which is right now in the west of Saudi Arabia, in the north part. So these were the people who were known as Madianites, Mada'in. That was the area known as Mada'in. And Saleh al-Islam was the prophet, and we know the story about the she camel and her baby, what they did to her. Inshallah, we will talk about it when it will come. So they were also very tall and long, big and powerful, mighty people. Quran talk about it. Jabu Sakhra Bilwad, they used to build, carve the mountains and rocks and big mansion in the mountain they would build. And we know from the study, you know, it, Arab is a desert now, but at one time it was supposedly was a greenish area or more what you call the fertile land, and they would make aqua tracks and the water underground. And this is both places, in the place of the Ad and the Samud, there is a underwater channels and underground water channels, and they made a reservoir where the water was stored during the storm and rain, so they would use it later in the time. So it is a necropolis, is a city which is built, which is right now, if you go and Google, you will see Petra, and you will see that how they build those structures without any mechanical device and power drills and power tools. And they did it, and they were so mighty and powerful. And they were also, again, idol worshiper and arrogant and dishonest people. They become, because you know, might and power corrupt the people, and the wealth and looks make it arrogant. So they were proud and arrogant and always thinking of themselves as superior to the others. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then destroyed them with one thing, and inshallah we'll talk about detail. The third nation, and again, these are the second Arab, Arab-e-Araba, Arab-e-Ba'ida. These are the two people. First was the Qawm-e-Ad, second was the Qawm-e-Samud, and third people who are mentioned in this ayah or this surah next is وَفِرْعَوْنَ ذِي الْعَوْتَادِ الَّذِينَ تَغَوْا فِي الْبِلَادِ, that Firaun, who was the king, he was such a mighty king of his time. Autad means pegs, you know, as this is the peg shaped structure. So either Firaun is referred to here, either with he built the pyramids, or it is, because all these three nations could not find any other information about their physical structure, but their leftover history is found. Aad, you cannot find much except that what NASA discovered, which is in what is known as the Qatr, the quarter, empty quarter, because there's so desert. Nobody lives in that in the Oman. A little bit north or northern border of the Oman. But these Petra, you can see the structures, and Fir'aun, we can see the pyramids. Another reference the ulama says, the Fir'aun az al-Awtad, the possessor of the pegs. The Fir'aun, the Pharaoh, the possessor of the pegs, is referred because his army was a very huge and mighty army he had, and they used to travel with the tents. And for the tents, they used to use the stakes, you know, the spears to hold the tents up. So this could be referred to that, but apparently it could be any mean. But what we knew, the structure, my mind is kind of agreeing with the Awtad means pyramid. This is the Ahram and Misr mentioned, because Ahram and Misr was there. So Awtad, Zil Awtad, possessor of the pyramid, because necropolis is also a dead place, you know, that they used to keep the body of the dead in that carving of the mountain. They used to make the necropolis means the city of dead. The Katina Murdakana, that's what they used to have it made in there. So Alladina Tahaw fil Bilad, and all of these were what? They were the one who were creating mischief. Tahaw, they were the rebellious. And they were becoming arrogant and rebellious. So this is what his Quran is referring. فَأَكْسُرُ فِيهَا الْفَسَادِ, and they have made plenty of fasad. فَأَكْسُرُ. So they have created severe mischief on the area wherever they would go. They will destroy, they will pledge, they will rob, they will steal. And then they will not take care of the poor people, of the poor and needy and, you know, orphan. So they were often, you know, kind of a dishonest and very rebellious people. As we know, the nature of the human haven't changed. Any nation which today become powerful, as we know what the European did when they invaded Muslim country, and what we know when the Mongol invaded Muslim country, what they did to them. So we know that whenever a nation overpowered, when Russian took over Central Asia, when the American went into the Afghanistan and Iraq, what they did, carpet bombing. So they think they are above the law. This is what this is fasad they will talk about. So fasabba alayhim rabbuka sawta azab. So when this happened, so what happened? So your Lord sent rain of the striking of the whip on them. You know, of the punishment. तो इसका मतलब जैसे कहें तुम्हारे रब ने अजाब का कोड़ा बड़ी कुव्वत से मारा उन पर, यानी कि फसब अलैहिम रब्बुका सौत अजाब. सौत means the you know with the call lash, जो कोड़ा कहते हैं ना उसको, सौत फसब बरसा दिया, यानी अल्लाह ताला ने उन पे अजाब के कोड़े बरसा दिए. ऐसा मतलब इसको मुहावरे में ऐसा बोला जाएगा, अल्लाह सुभान व तआला स्ट्राइक देम लाइक अ रेन फॉल ऑन देम ऑफ द स्ट्राइकिंग व्हिप्स. Inna rabbaka labil mirsad. Indeed, your Lord is watching, is out there in the preparation. Mirsad means somebody who is hiding and watching. You know, that if you go into a trail and you find there's a bushes and somebody ambush you. So the ambusher is the mirsad. The one who is hiding in a camouflage and you without your knowledge and you're not ready, and then you get attacked. So this is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, even though you don't see me, but I am watching over you. I can strike you whenever I want. So indeed your Lord, O Muhammad, strike them. فَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ. Now the topic is now changing to the humanity now. So you see three oath, three nation. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, what happened to their rebellion? What happened to the earth and moon and days and night? Their honor and respect and the evens and odd and the creation and all that. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing the topic down to فَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ. Now talking about the insan, the nature of a human. فَأَمَّا الْإِنسَانُ إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ رَبُّهُ فَأَكْرَمَهُ وَنَعَمَهُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَكْرَمَنَ. So when your Lord, when the insan is be given by test from the Lord, from his Lord, when Allah gave a test to his servant and give them honor and give them the reward, like our everything which we have is the inam of Allah, our body, our parents, our family, our children, our wealth, our physical, our other wellness and health, wealth and everything we possess is the ni'mah, because we don't deserve any of it. We could have been made an animal, we could have been made a rock. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made us human. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, the man which is such a weak creature when it's birth, yet we have rewarded him with all the ni'mah, all the rewards of him. فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَكْرَمًا. So when we give him these things to test him, he thinks he's been honored by his Lord, and it has been given ikram. So when we get wealth, we get material possession, we think Allah is good to us. So every rich man or everybody with the wealth become arrogant. When people have the knowledge, they become arrogant. We know Shaitan was arrogant about his knowledge. So as we know, many people who are with the professional knowledge and being wealthy and respected, they think they are above the other people and they try to look down on other people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, when we test him by giving all these ni'mah, so, and we give him ikram. He's supposed to be humble and be more kind and thankful to Allah and to the creation of which we have given him responsibility for the less fortunate. Yet he thinks he is better than Allah. وَأَمَّا إِذَا مَبْتَلَاهُ فَقَدَرْ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقُهُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَهَانَ. And when we test him, so when he's been tested by his Lord, by restricting his risk, all those things which we just mentioned, his wealth, health, and every possession and knowledge, and when it has been restricted a little bit, then he thinks Lord has dishonored him. And the reality is that Allah is testing some by giving and some by depriving. كَلَّا نَي بَلْ لَا تُكْرِمُونَ الْيَتِيمِ. Now Allah is turning the topic to an orphan. You indeed, nay, you absolutely do not honor the orphan. Now, honor of an orphan is a very technical and important term to understand. The greatest of the orphan born on the earth is our beloved Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When his mother father got married, they were a young couple, and 6 months, within 3-6 months of her pregnancy, she lost her husband Abdullah bin Abdul Muttalib, the father of Muhammad Rasulullah bin Abdullah, Muhammad bin Abdullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and Amna bint Wahab, a young girl without living in the city of Medina, born and raised there, have to leave her family because she was now widowed. Her husband died within 6 months of a young man, and when she had to move into Mecca to live with her father-in-law, with his quarters for his Abdullah's house, which was Abdul Muttalib radiallahu anhu, who was taking care of them, and then she was a wife without a husband, a young girl in a new country, a new people, a new family, without having anybody to look after except her father-in-law to be there attending. So when this young girl came in, and that time Prophet was born, and he was yatim when he was born, there was no father. So the if anybody we should care for is the orphan, because if we think the Prophet Muhammad was the best person ever born, Allah chose a best man to be born as an orphan, and he was a yasir within 6 years of his birth. When he was about 6 years old, Allah took his mother away. So she was about 20, 22 year old. If she got married to 14 to 16, then 20 to 22 years age is that. And in this very short time he spent with his mother, because 6 years he was living with Halima Sadia in the Banu Sa'd tribe, which was away from Mecca. So he really never had to live with his mother or his father, because when he came home, his mother took him to visit her family in Medina with the Ayman. And on her way back, after staying there for some time, she got sick on the path, and then she passed away in the place of Abwa, which is right now their place and is known. And the Saudi government, the wretched people, have destroyed her tomb, thinking it's a place of shirk. Na'uza billah. May Allah's curse be upon those who think that people do shirk as a Muslim. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless her and her husband and her family. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing us. We do not honor the orphan. Now we know that in Arab, in those days, and it's still today, Muslim and all over the world, we know that if anybody's orphan, especially the girl orphan, female orphan, are being taken. In those days, they used to take the girl, they take the possession of the leftover of the inheritance of the parents, and they will keep her as a wife, yet they would not want to keep her, give her the rights of a status of a wife, but they would like to keep her as a wife, and they would abuse her. They will take her wealth and say, well, I spend money on you, and this is all the part of payback, which was a dishonesty. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala further says, وَلَا تَحَادُونَ عَلَىٰ تَعَمِ الْمِسْكِينَ وَتَأْكُلُونَ التُّرَاثَ أَكْلًا لَمَّا وَتُحِبُّونَ الْمَالَ حُبًّا جَمَّا. Now we will stop here. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you do not encourage, you do not tell, or do not, remind and make people, raghbat dilana, jisko kehte hai. Tahaduna means raghbat dilana. You do not incite and motivate people to feed the food to the hungry and the poor and destitute. This is the greatest need of human existence, is food, water, clothing, shelter. This is how three priorities goes in human existence. First, we need food and water. Second thing, we need something to cover. Third thing, we need a shelter. Roti, kapra, aur makan. Yehi to kaha jata hai na. تو روٹی جو ہے اللہ سبحانہ وتعالیٰ سے کہ یو گائز ڈونٹ ایون دیز پیپل آر دا قریش اللہ از ٹاکنگ ٹو دیٹ یو ڈو ناٹ انکریج ایچ ادر یو ڈو ناٹ موٹیویٹ پیپل ٹو فیڈ دا پور اینڈ ہنگری اینڈ ڈیسٹیٹیوٹ مسکین از دا پرسن دیر از اے فقیر اینڈ اے غریب اینڈ اے مسکین مسکین از دا ون ہو ڈز ناٹ ایون ہیو انف فار دا ٹو ٹائمز میل غریب از دا ون فقیر از دا ون ہو ڈز ناٹ ہیو ون ٹائم میل سو دیر از اے فقیر اینڈ دیر از اے مسکین وچ از غریب فقیر اینڈ غریب مسکین پیپل آر دوز ہو ہیو نو وے ٹو گو آؤٹ اینڈ فائنڈ دا فوڈ میک لیونگ سو دیز آر دا پیپل ہو آر ویٹنگ فار سمبڈی ٹو گیو دم سم فوڈ وی آفن سے یو شوڈ چیک بفور یو فیڈ پیپل وائی شوڈ یو چیک وین اللہ گیو یو انف ڈیڈ ہی چیک یو We deserve to be having four times meal and a refrigerator full of food. It's flowing out and we're throwing so much food outside and garbage and not feeding people. So this is a reminder. Islam is a religion. And I'm sure all other religions also promote feeding the poor and destitute and sick and needy. وَتَأْكُلُونَ التُّرَاثَ أَكْلًا لَمَّا And you eat the inheritance of the people with gathering it. اکل لما مینس اس کو جمع کر کر کے اس کو کھا جاتے ہیں سمیٹ سمیٹ کر کے ہڑپ کر لینا مینس یو پیپل آر سو گریڈی دس شوز دا گریڈ یو ایٹ دا فوڈ ایز اللہ سبحانہ وتعالیٰ سیز ان اندر دا پلیس آف دی آیہ دیٹ دوز ہو ایٹ دا فوڈ اور دا انہیریٹنس آف دا آرفن از دے آر فلنگ دیئر اسٹمک ود دا فائر And there are very strong hadith in about it. So we need to be very careful. When these ayahs were revealed, Sahaba used to separate the food of their relative orphan kids. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then revealed the Quran and Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, don't do that. Don't outcast them. Because they were afraid that if we mix our food with their food, it means we are going to be in trouble. Allah, the Prophet says, no, this is about those who cheat and lie and take away the food and say that it is ours, not yours. So this is, وَتُحِبُّونَ الْمَالَ حُبًّا جَمَّا And you love the wealth, the world, the possession so much that you love to collect it and count it. Don't we count? I mean, I found myself counting how much money I have, how much money I earned, how much money I have to get. And the fact Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He gave me, He did not count it. As some says that when you count the sabah, those sabah which are mentioned, do it. But do the zikr of Allah unlimited because Allah is unlimited. So He would reward you unlimited. So do not do count in certain time. And this is some kind of understanding. Do not take it my word literal because sabah we do in the after the salah. So there are certain numbers Prophet have mentioned, but we should not count well that how much I earn in the sense that adding it more. So what will happen? If I die today, whatever I collect belong to my family or the debt I had owed to the people. So we should be clear of debts. This is what is the most important part. Prophet ﷺ would not perform the salah of a person who has come to him with it indebted. He said, no, you guys make salah. Or somebody would guarantee to pay his debt. This is why we ask in the grave when we are burying that anybody have owned to this person, either you take now or claim now or forgive him so that he could be buried in peace. So that person will not enter to the Jannah if he owes somebody wealth or somebody's debt and loan. So we should forgive our people. So Allah will reward us in the day of judgment.